This conference will now be recorded.
So, nystagmus means the eyeball will move with small movements when you try to focus on an object. Okay, so it is a regular, repetitive, rhythmic to and fro. That is a pendulous movement. You know what is pendulous, right? In a ball clock, you'll have a pendular movement. In that same way, it will move to and fro of the, this is the to and fro movement of the eyes. Okay, so this movement can be horizontal like your clock, or it can be vertical, or it can be torsional. You know torsions, right? Inward and outward movements is torsional movement. So this can be any type of movement. So these nystagmus movements will have some characteristics. It can be pendular movement like your wall clock, or it can be a jerk movement. It will move like a jerk. Tuck, 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 like that. It will move like a jerk nystagmus. So in jerk nystagmus, what happens? One movement will be slow. One direction of the movement will be slow, and the second movement will be fast. So it goes in a slow movement in one direction and comes back in a fast movement like tuck. Okay. So that is the difference between pendular and jerk movement. In pendular movement, both the movements will be of equivalent velocity and amplitude. Okay, so the movements can be a rapid movement or a slow movement. It can be a latent or manifest. Latent means which is hidden. I told you previously what is latent squint, right? Latent means which is hidden. Manifest means when you see a person, immediately you can say and diagnose that the patient is having nystagmus. Latent means which is hidden, and once you break the fusion, then only it will come into action. Okay, so it can be a latent or a manifest nystagmus. Before going into deep with in nystagmus, we have to know few terms like amplitude, frequency, intensity, null zone, pursuit or saccade, conjugate or dissociated, jerk and pendular movements. So coming to amplitude. Amplitude is the excursion of the nystagmus, and it is described in degrees. Okay, that is how much nystagmus the patient is having, it can be measured in degrees. If it is some patients will have mild nystagmus, which is about 5 degrees or less than 5 degrees, then it is called as normal or fine nystagmus. Moderate amplitude means about 5 degrees to 15 degrees. Larger or greater than 15 degrees is very high amplitude. Okay, so this is called amplitude. Now coming to frequency, frequency means a number. Number of to and fro movement that a patient will have in nystagmus in 1 second. 1 second. So in 1 second, how many movements the patient will have nystagmus to and fro movement, then it is called as frequency. So described as cycles per second or hertz. So slow means 1 to 2, medium means 3 to 4, if it is fast means more than 5, okay, more than or equal to 5. So frequency is number of times the patient will have to and fro motion in 1 second. Now coming to intensity, amplitude multiplied by frequency gives you the intensity. So there is another term called as null zone. There is a particular position where the nystagmus will have minimal movement. That position is called as null zone. Okay. Position where nystagmus is minimized, then it is called as null zone. Patient assumes a head posture such that the eyes are in null zone. Because the patient is having continuous movement of the eyeball, the patient will not be able to fix on a particular object. He can't fix on a particular object. So to fix on a particular object, the patient turns his head or tilts his or her head to focus, to get the eyeballs into that null zone, so that at least he can try, he will have some chance of focusing on an object. So this null zone is very important in nystagmus. Depending upon where the null zone is present, the patient will move his head and brings the viewing point into that null zone. Okay. So next one is pursuit and saccade. Pursuit eye movement allow the eyes to closely follow a moving object. Pursuit different from the vestibular ocular reflex. I'll tell you what is vestibular ocular reflex in the next slides, which occurs only during movement of the head and serves to stabilize gaze on a stationary object. saccades are quick simultaneous movement of both eyes in the same direction. So in this pursuit and saccades means they are quick movements which both eyes will have the same type of movement in the same direction. Okay, pursuits or closely they follow a moving object. If you're seeing the object, if you follow that moving object, then it is pursuit. Okay, next is conjugate and dissociative. Conjugate means symmetric in direction, amplitude and frequency. Rate or frequency is the same. Okay, so conjugate means both eyes, the nystagmus will be the same. Okay, so dissociated, when it differs from one another parameters between the two eyes. So different, both eyes will have different type of direction, different type of amplitude or different type of rate, whatever it is. In these three, anything can differ. Then it is called as dissociated type of nystagmus. So conjugate means, as the name indicates, it is always same in both eyes. Okay. Next, jerk and pendular. Okay. This is I told you already. So you can see in this you can see the below diagram here. You can see this is pendular nystagmus. See, they are like, you know, they're smooth, moving in the same. See the difference between this wave and this wave, the same thing, right? But here you can see jerk nystagmus. Here, see, the line is straight. Okay, this is the fast phase. I told you that one direction will be slow and the second direction will be fast. So this is a slow phase. That is, you are having a slanting line here. This is a slow phase and this is a fast phase. Okay, so this is depending upon the position of the eye. Okay, so this is called as jerk nystagmus and this is called as pendular nystagmus. So there is a very important law to understand nystagmus. That is called as Alexander's law. It states that the amplitude of jerk nystagmus is largest in the gaze of direction of the fast component. You can see fast component, right? This is the fast component or this is the slow component. So the amplitude of jerk nystagmus, that is amplitude means, I told you amplitude in this jerk nystagmus. This is mute. All of you please mute your mics. Some disturbance is there. If you have any doubt, you can ask, but otherwise, just mute your mics. So amplitude of jerk nystagmus is largest in the gaze of direction of fast component. So first degree nystagmus only in the direction of the fast component. There are three degrees in this law. Second degree nystagmus in primary gaze position. Third degree nystagmus in addition to above two gazes also present in the direction of the slow component. So there are 3 degrees according to Alexander's law, and this law implies only for jerk nystagmus. Okay. So what is, why there is nystagmus mechanisms? Normally when you see object, the image of this object will fall on the fovea, right? Then only you can perceive the image and the signals will go into the brain and you are able to see what that image is, right? So in nystagmus, what happens? Foveal centration of an object of rigor is necessary to obtain the highest level of visual acuity. Unless the object or image goes and falls on the fovea, you will not able to see the image properly. Okay, so this falling of the image on the fovea is disturbed because of 3 mechanisms. One is fixation, second one is vestibular ocular reflex, and third one is neural integration. The name all itself will say. Right, first one is fixation. Fixation means you have to keep your eyes in the primary gaze. Primary gaze means straight, right? In primary gaze, that is the fixation. Fixation in the primary position involves the visual system's ability to detect a drift of a foveating image and signal an appropriate corrective eye movement to refoveate the image of the record. So what happens when you see an object? Actually, this sentence is a little bit complicated. To see an object, you have to fix the eyeball first, and the image has to fall on the fovea, and the fovea has to resend the signals to the brain to pursue the image of Rika, right? So in vestibular system, it's intimately and complexly involved with this system of visual acuity, right? So along with this, your vestibular system also should involve to get proper fixation. So what is this vestibular ocular reflex, also called as gaze stabilizing reflex? What is gaze? That is your movement of the eyeball, gaze. The gaze is stabilized. This vestibular ocular reflex will stabilize your gaze. Okay. The vestibular ocular reflex is a complex system of neural interconnections that maintains foveation of an object during changes in head position. So what happens? The sensory signals encoding head movements are transformed into motor that generate compensatory eye movements in the opposite direction of the head movement, thus ensuring stable vision. Okay. For example, I'll tell you, if you want to see an image which is in your primary gaze, okay, but somebody is calling you, I want you to change your head movement towards your friend, but you want to see simultaneously the image in your primary gaze. So what you will do, you will try to move the image, your head, but your eyeballs will be near the image which is in the straight position. So this movement of the head along with your, which coordinates with the movement of the eyeballs is very important for your perception. For this vestibular ocular reflex is very important because it converts the signals, it encodes the sensory signals and convert them into motor signals, and it will give you the image. Okay, and the third one is, I told you three things, that is fixation, vestibular ocular reflex and neural integration. And the third one is neural integration. When the eye is turned to an extreme position, that is the extreme right or extreme left in the orbit, the fascia and ligaments that suspend the eye exert an elastic force and to return towards the primary position. To overcome this force, a tonic contraction of the extraocular muscles is required. For example, if you want to see into extremes of your right, again your eye tends to move towards the primary gaze. You can't keep your eyeball in the extreme right or extreme left forever, right? If you want to see an object in your extreme right, again you'll see the object and again you'll bring it to the primary position. To get your eyeball from the extreme right or left to the primary gaze, many things have to work, like fascia, ligaments, muscles, all those things should work to bring the eyeball into the primary gaze. So during this process, there will be a contraction of the extraocular muscles. So the gaze holding network, so this gaze holding, that means it will bring the eyeball to the center to hold the gaze in the primary position. Okay, to keep your eyeball in the primary position, many things will work. This complete network is called as neural integrator. This generates signal. Okay, this generates signals and sent to the brain, the cerebellum, ascending vestibular pathway, and oculomotor nuclei. All these things will coordinate and work together to bring your eyeball to the primary position after you move your eyeball to the extremes. Okay, so this is called as neural integrated. Okay, so we will see what happens in nystagmus. In the in point of view of fixation, when the fovea is not fixating properly, because the fovea is not well developed or there is some problem in the fovea, there is no fixating point in the eye. Right, so what happens? Fixation will not occur and there will be nystagmus. Now, vestibular ocular reflex, because there is no stabilization of the gaze, because of this vestibular ocular reflex, the fovea is normal, but gaze stabilizing the reflex is not there. It's not proper. Then what happens? The gaze is not in the primary position and it will tend moving. This leads to nystagmus. And neural integrator. Because this neural integrator doesn't generate signal and send properly, what happens? The eye will have nystagmus. Okay. So this is all about basics of nystagmus. Now coming to classification of nystagmus. So nystagmus can be physiological or pathological. There are many types of classifications for nystagmus, but the most accepted is CMAS classification, that is classification of eye movement abnormalities. It divides the nystagmus into physiological and pathological. So in physiological, optokinetic nystagmus, endpoint nystagmus, and vestibular nystagmus, these I will deal at the end of this session. Now, coming to pathological nystagmus, it can be congenital or acquired. So, in congenital infantile nystagmus syndrome, which is very important. Next one is fusion maldevelopment nystagmus syndrome, FMNS, and spasmus mutant syndrome. These three come under congenital, that is from birth. Acquired due to disorders of the visual fixation, due to vestibular imbalance, acquired pendular nystagmus, and due to the disorders of gaze holding. So these three, remaining three we know, but acquired pendular nystagmus, I'll tell you what is acquired pendular nystagmus also. So these are divided into congenital and acquired. Now coming to the first one, infantile nystagmus, usually not noted at birth, but becomes apparent in the first few days, few months of life. What are the characteristics of this infantile nystagmus? It is always a horizontal nystagmus. It can be a mixture of both pendular and jerk nystagmus. So it is usually bilateral, that is conjugate type of nystagmus. It's not present during the sleep because there is no visual fixation. Head turns to HU null point. I told you what is null point. Where the nystagmus is minimized, that point is called as null point or null zone. So the baby tries to turn his or her head to get the fixation into that null point. Decreases with convergence and increases with fixation. If the baby tries to fix on an object, the nystagmus will increase. These are the typical features of infantile nystagmus. Okay, so there is optokinetic drum, you know, that you have seen in this physiology also, you'll see. Okay. So what is the treatment for this congenital nystagmus or infantile nystagmus? We have to give prisms. So prisms, what happens? Prism with base out. What is prism with base out? So imagine, I'm just drawing with this arrow mark. So if you take this as a triangle, okay, this is the base of the triangle, right? This is the apex of the triangle. So this base should be out, means base should be, if you think this is the eyeball, that is your left eyeball, okay, you have to keep the base here. Base out means it should not be towards the nose, it should be outside, the base has to be outside. So it is called as a base out prism. If you keep the base out, it induces convergence. Why? The features of prisms are always, the ray will always deviate towards the apex. So all the rays will deviate towards the apex and there will be convergence. So this, with this convergence, there will be decrease in the nystagmus and the visual acuity may improve. Okay, use of prism should shift the viewing point to null position, because when you use prisms, you keep the object in the null position. Contact lens may also be used, can also be used. Gabapentin can also be used, but results are uncertain. This includes moving of the extraocular muscles to place the null zone in primary position. This null zone is very important in nystagmus, because in early childhood, if you treat properly, you can get rid of this nystagmus. How they will do the surgery, they'll keep the null position in the primary gaze position. That is, the primary gaze means gaze. They'll bring the null position to this primary gaze by moving the extraocular muscles. This is called as Kestenbaum procedure, which is very important. Recession of all the recti muscle to decrease the tension so that the nystagmus decreases. This is called as large recession procedure. Now the second type is spasmus mutans. It consists of a triad nystagmus, along with the patient will have head nodding and torticollis, that is head tilt or head turn. These three are the triad of spasmus mutans. One is nystagmus, head nodding and torticollis. So usually during the first year of life, that between approximately 3 to 15 months of age, usually disappears by 3 to 4 years of age. It consists of, this type of nystagmus will have small amplitude but high frequency. High frequency means number of rate in 1 second, very high frequency oscillations, usually bilateral but can be monocular also, asymmetric and variable in different gaze positions. Usually it is benign. Neuroimaging is recommended. Gliomas may mimic spasmus mutans. Okay. Now the third type in congenital is fusion maldevelopment nystagmus syndrome. Usually previously they used to call this, depending upon the other classifications, old classifications, it is called as latent or latent manifest nystagmus. It has very particular characteristics. The patient will have squint, usually infantile onset because the type 1 are infantile. Infantile onset, strabismus present, intensity decreases with age. Nystagmus is not present when the both eyes are open. Manifests only when one eye is covered. That's the reason it is called as latent nystagmus, or initially latent, once you cover it manifests. So it is called as latent manifest nystagmus also. Okay, once you cover the eye only, then only the patient will have nystagmus. A patient with squint comes to you, you have to compulsory do cover uncover test. Once you cover and uncover test, sometimes the patient will have nystagmus also. So how the nystagmus jerk with rapid pace towards the uncovered eye. So uncovered eye, the jerk will have rapid phase. I told you that jerk nystagmus will have two phases, rapid and slow phase. So the rapid phase will always be towards the uncovered eye. Okay. So these are all the types of congenital or infantile nystagmus. There are three types. Okay. Now coming to the acquired type. Okay. So acquired type, first one is nystagmus associated with poor vision, that is because of sensory thing. So because of any media that is obstructing the light rays to go and fall on the fovea can lead to sensory nystagmus, also called as sensory nystagmus. So anterior segment, any cataract, any inner area, retinal diseases, retinoblastoma, intrauterine infections and ROP. Okay, these are all the causes for poor vision nystagmus, that is sensory nystagmus. Now coming to motor nystagmus, that is due to some neurological diseases. End gauge paratic nystagmus or convergence attraction nystagmus. Okay, I'll tell you these in the last. Okay, and coming to the third one, vestibular nystagmus is very important because vestibulo-ocular reflex is very important in this type of vestibular nystagmus. This can be two types. Sorry for the bad presentation. This can be two types. It can be peripheral or the second one is central. Okay. In peripheral, there is conjugate, horizontal, jerk with fast phase away from the side of the lesion. Okay. So this is very typical vestibular nystagmus. So the lesion can be in the labyrinthines or eighth cranial nerve. Okay. Now coming to central nystagmus, that is the lesion is in the brainstem nuclei. There are various types in central nystagmus: upbeat, downbeat, CISA, and periodic alternating nystagmus. These are four types we see in central types of central vestibular nystagmus. Now coming to the first one in the central vestibular nystagmus, upbeat, as the name indicates, you can see the arrows. Always the nystagmus will be in the, the fast phase will be in the upward direction in primary position. It is always a jerk nystagmus, and it is the upbeat means the fast phase will be in the upward direction and often worsens when the patient sees in the up gaze. When he sees up, it becomes worse. Causes lesions in the medulla and cerebellar vermis and midbrain. Treatment, base up. Okay, the prism should be base up. I told you base up means the base will be kept in the up and apex in the down. Okay. In reading glasses can be used to force the eye in the downward position. When you keep the prism apex down, the prism will make the eyeball to turn downwards. Okay. So this is called as upbeat nystagmus. See how the image is. The fast phase will be in the up phase. Okay. Now coming to downbeat nystagmus, the fast phase will be in the downward direction as the name indicates. Often versus with down gaze. Okay. Now causes a cervicomedullary junction. Treatment, base down prism. Okay, so that the eye see. Here you can see how the image is. The fast phase is in the downward direction. Now coming to the third type, seesaw nystagmus. It is a pendular nystagmus. So upbeat and downbeat nystagmus are jerk nystagmus. And seesaw nystagmus is a pendular nystagmus with elevation and intorsion of one eye simultaneously with the depression and extraction of the other eye. So both eyes will be in different position. Okay, so up one eye will be in elevation. Okay, one eye will be in elevation along with intorsion. Okay, and the second eye will be opposite depression and extorsion, followed by reversal of the cycle. Okay, so that the eye, this is binocular. In both eyes, nystagmus will be there, and one eye one direction and the second eye will be another direction, and next they will become reverse, the vice versa, and well, there will be seesaw movement of the eyeball. Okay, so causes paracellular regions and pituitary tumors. Produces very disabling oscillopsia that responds poorly to any treatment. Usually no treatment works with this type of nystagmus. Next, fourth type in vestibular central nystagmus are, let's say, is periodic alternating nystagmus called as PAN. It is a conjugate horizontal jerk nystagmus. So among the four in the central vestibular nystagmus, jerk nystagmus with a fast pace beating in one direction for a period of approximately 1 to 2 minutes. So what happens in this? First, the patient slow phase and he comes to fast phase. Slow phase is over and comes to fast phase, and he will remain in the fast phase for about 1 to 2 minutes with a small jerky beats. Okay, so the nystagmus has intervening neutral phase lasting about 10 to 20 seconds. So the nystagmus begins to beat in the opposite direction for 1 to 2 minutes, then the process repeats itself. Okay, so alternating nystagmus, periodic alternating, 1 to 2 minutes it will have a fast phase, then 10 to 20 second break, again 1 to 2 minutes it will have fast phase, like that, alternating periodic nystagmus. Okay, the periodic alternating head turn to minimize the nystagmus. So patient will have some head turn, causes lesion in the cerebellum. So these are all types of central nystagmus. So vestibular nystagmus, I told you about peripheral and central, right? So differences between these two, this is in the vestibular region and this is in the brainstem. Intensity increases when the eyes are turned in the direction of the fast phase. Direction of the nystagmus may change with the gaze. So visual fixation, it inhibits the nystagmus. When the patient tries to fix properly, then it inhibits the nystagmus, but in central, no, it will not happen. Vertigo is very severe in peripheral, and in central it is mild. Induced by high movement is often, but it's rare. Eye movement, but in central you can see persistent saccadic movements. Other findings in peripheral, hearing loss is there because vestibular origin, and the central one there is CNS involvement. So next one is gauge paritic nystagmus. So in this equine, I told you about fixation, vestibular imbalance. Now the third one is gauge paritic. So gauge paritic nystagmus is the most common type. Absent in primary position and it is not visually disabling. Beats in the direction of the gaze, causes some anticonvulsants, brainstem lesions, cerebellar lesions, all these things. So there are various types, 5 types in gaze paritic nystagmus. First one is gaze evoked, dissociated or disconjugate, convergence retraction syndrome, Brunt syndrome, centripetal or rebound nystagmus. Now coming to the first one, gaze evoked. There is no nystagmus in the primary gaze. The patient will not have any primary gaze nystagmus. Slow conjugate horizontal jerk nystagmus in the direction of the gaze. In the primary gaze, the patient will not have any nystagmus. The patient tries to move the eyeball. If the patient is trying to move the eyeball to his right, okay, then you can see slow conjugate horizontal jerk nystagmus. Sorry, nystagmus in the direction of the gaze. That is towards the right side. The patient will have the nystagmus towards the right side. So causes brainstem and for posterior fossa lesions, CNS depression because of some drugs like anticonvulsants and barbiturates and alcoholism. All these things relate because when there is movement in the gaze, nystagmus is coming into action. So this is called as gaze evoked nystagmus. Okay. Second type, dissociated or disconjugate nystagmus, pathological, usually unilateral by abducting and occasionally by adducting eyes. Okay. So the most common cause is internuclear ophthalmoplegia. Okay. Convergence retraction syndrome. Jerk with bilateral fast component towards the medial cell. Always the fast phase will be towards the medial side. Usually associated with retraction of the globe on convergence. When convergence, the globe will go back. That is retraction of the globe. Usually associated with pinealoma, stroke, trauma, and multiple sclerosis. Now, fourth type is Bruns nystagmus. Because cerebropontine angle tumor, the most common type. Okay, so common cause, low frequency, large amplitude. That is, count will be less, but amplitude will be high when patient looks towards the side of the lesion. And vice versa. And vice versa means when the patient looks opposite side, that is away from the lesion, there will be high frequency and low amplitude. Okay, opposite to gaze evoker type of nystagmus. You can see gaze evoker type. In this, what happens when the patient sees to the extremely towards the lesion, then the patient will have nystagmus. Here, away from the this thing, the patient will have more frequency nystagmus. So these are all about congenital and acquired nystagmus. Okay. So there are nystagmus associated with strabismus. I told you that in some cases with nystagmus, there will be a strabismus. Okay. So latent or manifest latent nystagmus, we discussed about it. Manifest nystagmus, even in primary gaze also the patient will have, or in normal without cover and uncover test also, along with squint, the patient will have nystagmus. And the third one is nystagmus blockade syndrome. So this nystagmus blockade syndrome, first we'll talk about manifest and manifest latent nystagmus. Okay, these two differences. So in manifest nystagmus, it is pendular. This is jerk nystagmus. No change on abduction. There is increase with abduction because convergence is involved in this. No change on covering of one eye. This will manifest only when one eye is covered. Okay, null zone is present. Fast phase always towards the fixing eye. Less commonly associated with infantil esotropia. Always associated with infantil esotropia. So always infantile esotropia will have this type of manifest latent nystagmus. Binocular visual acuity same as uniocular. Binocular visual acuity is better than uniocular. So this is all about pathological nystagmus. Now coming to physiological nystagmus, there are three types. Endpoint nystagmus, vestibular nystagmus or caloric or rotational nystagmus, and optokinetic nystagmus. So endpoint nystagmus, jerk nystagmus, the eyeball will go to its endpoint on looking extreme lateral or upwards. The gaze angle will be more than 45 degrees. Okay, it's a very high degree of deviation. Okay, so vestibular nystagmus, as this is also jerk nystagmus. Altered inputs from vestibular nuclei to PPRF, demonstrated by caloric test, cold water, warm water. This is called as caloric test. Okay. So cold water opposite, when you keep cold water, opposite side of the nystagmus will improve, and in warm water, the same side. Okay. When you keep it in the ears, cold water in both ears, the eyeball will move upwards. Warm water in both ears, eyeball will move downwards. When you put cold water in opposite side ear, then you can see jerk nystagmus. When you keep warm water in same side, then you see jerk nystagmus. Okay. So the third one is optokinetic nystagmus. It is also a type of nystagmus, jerk nystagmus. So induced by moving a full visual field stimulus. So it has a slow phase and a fast phase. Slow phase, eye follows the target. Fast phase, eye fixates on next target. Okay. Detecting malingering test visual potential in children. So optokinetic drum will be there. With that, we will see the test. Now coming to the final thing, nystagmus blockade syndrome. So it has some inverse relationship with esotropia. So this is blocking the nystagmus. Okay, so the fixing eye is preferred to be in adduction, face toward the turns in the direction of the fixing eye. So what is this? Nystagmus blockade syndrome. It is having some inverse relationship with esotropia. So esotropia is a mechanism of blocking the nystagmus. If sometimes esotropia is present, then this causes blockage of the nystagmus. That's the reason it's called as nystagmus blockage syndrome. So there are conditions which mimic nystagmus. It is not true nystagmus, but some conditions are there which mimic nystagmus. These are called as nystagmoid conditions, okay, or nystagmoid movements. These movements are not regular and rhythmic like normal nystagmus. So it can be oculopalatal myoclonus, opsoclonus, or ocular, and the third one is ocular bobbing. So oculopalatal myoclonus, it is a type of vertical pendular nystagmus coexisting with the tremors of the facial muscles, larynx, and palate. It is usually present during sleep, usually develops months after an infarction in the, or hemorrhage involving molared triangle. Treatment is good with gabapentin. Second one is ocular bobbing, characterized by conjugate eye movements. Both eyes will have the same eye movements, beginning with a fast downward movement, followed by slow drift back to midline. So what happens initially, there will be a fast downward movement followed by slow movement to the center, not to the up, to the center. Example, comatose patients with massive pontine lesion and metabolic encephalopathy. These are not nystagmus, but they will have some mimicking features. Next one is superior oblique myokymia, defined as oscillation of one eye due to intermittent firing of the superior oblique muscle. So that's the reason superior oblique myokymia produces oscillopsia or intermittent diplopia. It is characterized by monocular rapid intorsional movements, usually benign, no treatment, no etiology is found, but we have to go for neuroimaging in review of posterior fossa tumors. So if the patient has refractory cases are there, we have to weaken the superior oblique muscle. Okay, you can see here. So we see inward direction because of superior oblique myokymia. So what are the treatment options for nystagmus? Non-surgical, that is in non-neurological cases, you can give, what we can do, we can give prisms. Okay, or sometimes over minus lenses can be useful and contact lenses also. We can use very helpful. Okay, prisms, but two prisms treatment of nystagmus always bears out. Okay, so next one is occlusion therapy. Trial with conventional occlusion has been found to be effective as in amblyopia gets corrected and vision improves, then nystagmus also decreases. So pharmacological treatment, they will have baclofen for congenital nystagmus, seesaw nystagmus and periodic alternating nystagmus, and carbamazepine for superior oblique myokymia. So pharmacological denervation with botulinum toxin. Okay, I told you last class also botulinum toxin is very important for muscle discipline. Surgical treatment. Okay, what are the principles of surgical treatment in nystagmus? We have to shift the null position to the primary position. We have to change the null position into the primary position. To induce extra convergence in a region by weakening medial recti to dampen nystagmus. So we have to weaken the medial recti. Third one is to reduce the amplitude of the nystagmus by weakening the muscle forces of all the recti. So first weakening of the medial recti is very important, along with that all other muscle forces also should be weakened to bring the eyeball into the primary position. I already told you what is Kaestenbaum surgery. Okay, recession of all the four recti muscles. So what we will do, left faint, so that we can bring the null zone into the primary position. So in right eye, the patient is having left turn face, then null is in dextroversion. Towards the right side, the patient will have null zone. Then what we have to do, right eye LR recession, that is lateral rectus recession and medial rectal resection, and the opposite we have to do in the left eye. There is another surgery called as Anderson's recession, sorry, Anderson surgery. Only recessions will be done in this. In Caesarbaum's, both the recession and resection is done, but in Anderson's only recession is done. In this, we will do only right eye, we will do only lateral rectus recession, and in left eye only medial rectus recession. No resection will be done in Anderson's. Next, another type of surgery is there called as Park surgery, which is for only little amount of recession you want to do, then we can go with Park surgery. So this is called as 5, 6, 7, 8 plan. Okay, what we will do? Medial rectus first we will do, that is 5, 6, lateral rectus then 7, 8. So first recession, then resection. So medial rectus recession 5, medial rectus resection 6, lateral rectus recession 7, and lateral rectus resection 8. So this is called as Park surgery, means 5, 6, 7, 8 plan. Okay, this is all about nystagmus. So do you have any doubts, please? You don't have any doubts, right?